First of all, thanks a lot for your warm wishes for the Teachers' Day. I have been touched and I have been blessed to have such kind of amazing student feedback, and I love the video that you guys have actually posted. And without any further ado, the purpose of this video is to guide you through your on-remote session-based CBE examinations for both skills level and strategic professional level examinations for September 2020 ACCA examinations, right? So without any delay, let's start. So the first and foremost thing that I need to discuss is what are the things that we need to do before starting our examination. The first point is to make sure that you have all the requirements of the examination ready. Please do the system test before an hour before you start your examination. The system test, as you guys have already done, please do it 1 hour before the examination. And what elements are we required to keep in hand, sir? You don't need an examination docket for the CBE exam, for remote CBE exam, so don't worry, no examination docket will be there. Next thing is, make sure you have a water bottle, and the water bottle should be like this. I don't know whether you guys are able to see this or not, but this is how your water bottle should look like. Okay, there should not be any labels or any stickers or anything on the water bottle. It has to be transparent. Okay, no labels are allowed. Then yes, you are allowed to have a calculator with you guys. No problem with using a calculator. You can use the normal calculator or you can use a scientific calculator as well. No rough paper is allowed. Students are thinking that two sheets of paper are allowed. Please be clear, that is for on-demand CBE examination. Remote on-demand CBE exam is for F1, F2, F3, F4 papers, the fundamental level papers, okay, the knowledge level papers. For skills level and professional level, this is session CBE. For session CBE, no white paper is allowed. So you are not supposed to have any sheet of piece of paper on your desk when you are giving the examination. Next one, internet connection. Please make sure that you have a stable internet connection. Many students were asking me, sir, can we use a dongle as a, the connectivity platform? Yes, you can use your dongle, but they have said that 3 Mbps of download speed and 2 Mbps of upload speed is mandatorily required for the examination. Some students have already tried it using a dongle and the system test gave them a pass result. But, you know, don't play with your exam or don't play with your life, because if you somehow do a mistake and it cost you, then you'll have to lose 3 months of your time. So let's not do that. Use your dongles as a backup. In case if there is any internet failure or disconnection, use your dongle as a backup plan, not as your stable connectivity. And next thing is, ACCA is very clear that once the PSMU software is running, no user interface will pop up. Usually your dongle will have a user interface where you'll have to enter some login ID, password or your mobile number or something, and you have to connect through that. So once you connect through that and start your exam, it may run, it may not run, but in the middle of the exam, you cannot switch to dongle connectivity. So that is not possible if you have a user interface. So please make sure that don't depend on the dongles. You can use them as a backup plan, but I wouldn't suggest having them. Next one is external keyboard, mouse and monitor. Yes, you are allowed to have an external keyboard, like a wireless keyboard, wireless mouse, and a monitor is also allowed. But a single monitor should be there. And if you are using the monitor, then the laptop screen should be closed. You cannot use two screens at the same time. Laptop screen closed and you can use the external monitor. Absolutely allowed, no problem. And next one is, you should have your valid identity proof. An Aadhaar card or a PAN card or your passport or whatever it is. Please make sure that you have your valid ID proof with you. And if you are below 18, if your age is below 18, you should have your, a guardian or a parent or whoever it is possible. And they should have their valid ID proof ready. And I don't think that at a skills level or professional level, you guys will be below 18. But again, if you are an exceptional case, then yes, you should have your guardian or parent ready with their valid ID proof. Next, regarding the bathroom break, this is again very important for many students. I don't know why, but yes, a bathroom break is allowed. One break is allowed for maximum of 5 minutes. Maximum of 5 minutes. Okay, you have to resume your exam within 5 minutes. And please make sure that you clear all such kind of requirements, before you start your examination, and try not to take any breaks, because even though you take a break, your countdown timer, your clock will keep ticking. So let's not do that. Don't waste any time in the middle of the examination for such kind of issues. But if it is mandatory, yes, you can take a single break of 5 minutes. Next one, what are the software requirements, sir? I'm not going to talk about the technical system requirements as such. You have to make sure that you do a system check 1 hour before the examination. And usually many students are having this issue. It is saying that some XYZ application is running, Magic Plus or else some IQ chart or different applications are running on your background bar. This is because you are using your laptop or PC for various other purposes. Maybe you have installed a game or maybe you have installed some trading platform software, whatever it is. So in that case, what you'll do is press Ctrl Alt Delete, a task manager will open, and from there you have to close whatever application is running. Okay, I'll show you on the screen. So I press Ctrl Alt Delete and I'm going to task manager. And from this task manager, what you need to do is you need to select which particular application it is asking for you to close. For example, it is asking me to close this, let's say Cortona. So I'll just select that, right click, and you need to click on the end task button. Okay. So like this, you need to choose which application needs to be closed and you need to close that application, right? And then moving on, internet connectivity, as I have told you, you have to punch in your mobile number before you start your examination for contact purpose. Sir, is a mobile allowed in the room? Yes, a mobile is mandatory to be placed in the room. And I'm not saying that it should be on your desk. Your mobile should be on silent, not even vibrate. Put it on absolute silent. And your mobile should not be within your arm's length reach. It should be out of your reach. So if you are writing the examination on your table, so make sure that the mobile is not on the table. You have to place it somewhere else, elsewhere. And if in case an internet connectivity issue or your technical issue, the software is suddenly stuck or it is not responding, so there will be a chat option provided within the PSMU. You can use that to inform the technical team. Sir, what if internet failure or what if power failure? There is no chat option, so what am I supposed to do? The technical team, invigilators, they will call you back on the given number and you need to take that call. Sir, what if I am unable to resume the examination within 5 minutes? They'll try for 5 minutes to resume your exam. If it is a valid cause and they see that, okay, if we try more, it will be done. They'll try to resume your examination, no issue. So within 5 minutes, if your exam is resumed, all your progress will be saved till that point of failure and you can resume your exam. The same timer will continue. If you are unable to continue, if you are, within 5 minutes, if your issue is not resolved, then you'll get the amount refunded to your MyACC account and you'll have to book the December window for that particular thing. There is no other alternative for you. Next one. What shall we do one night before the exam, sir? I hope that you guys are watching this on 6th of September. So 7th of September, you have your audit and assurance and advanced audit and assurance examination. So whenever you are watching this video, if you are having one night before the exam, what are you supposed to do? First and foremost thing is make sure that you have the good night sleep. You have a very good goddamn sound sleep. At least for a 6 to 8 hours of sleep is mandatory. Because since you will be stressed out at the time of examination, you have a countdown, you have a clock running. You need to make sure that you look at the same screen for 3 hours or 4 hours in case of SBL. You'll be draining out your eyes while looking at the same screen. And I faced this issue when I gave my CMA US examination. I didn't have proper sleep because I was traveling and my eyes were a little bit watered and I was unable to see the numbers properly. I had to take a break of 5 minutes during my examination and I have to clear my eyes out and I have to wait, and then I have, I somehow got a good vision back and I continued my exam. So don't do that to yourself. Don't dry out your eyes. Give a good night's sleep to your eyes. Okay. Mandatory. Otherwise, you'll just screw it up. As simple as that. You'll just screw it up in the examination if you don't have good sleep before the exam. So make sure you get a good night's sleep. And then, so before sleeping, there are so many students who do all-nighters, who pull out an all-nighter before the exam day. Okay, I used to be one of such students. When I was a student back then, I used to be a chichora guy, so I never studied, throughout the curriculum period, and then the one day before the exam, we used to do T20 batting. So yes, if you are such kind of a student, make sure that you sleep, during the day of one day before the examination. Suppose if your exam is on Monday, Sunday afternoon, you sleep like a baby. In the night, you start your plan, but make sure you get good sleep before the examination. As simple as that. Now, don't try to read new topics. What you will do is if you have left some topic as an, as a choice element, or for example, let's say you are giving APM exam and you are worried that, you left Lynch and Cross performance pyramid as a choice. You don't know what it is. So what I would suggest you to do is don't leave any topic completely untouched. Just go through with that once. I'm not saying that you should know in and out of that. Just go through with it once. Try to think, okay, fine, this is this. At least know something about that topic, as simple as that. For example, SBR students, 90% of SBR students leave financial instruments, IFRS 9, IAS 32 as a choice. So at least within that, try to know what is credit risk, what is allowances, what are derivative instruments, what are embedded derivatives, fair value through P&L, effective portion of hedge, ineffective portion of hedge. At least a little bit of that, try to understand. Okay, I'm not saying you'll get complete grip, but don't leave any point untouched. And at the same time, don't spend too much time on any given topic one day before the exam. Make sure that you get a complete quick revision. And if you have excess time, then go through the topics which you haven't dealt with properly. Okay, use your running notes or use your short notes or summary notes or else workbooks or whatever it is, resources is same. Make sure you revise the entire syllabus. And this is the most important point, ma'am. Read the previous examiner's comments to make sure you don't repeat those mistakes which your previous students who have sat for the previous window have made. ACCA releases this examiner comments for every window. Make sure you go through all of them. Okay, at least, all of them in the sense, your respective paper, the previous window, what are the examiner's comments, make sure you read them to understand what are the mistakes. For example, in audit, majority of the time, students are unable to differentiate between business risk and an audit risk. So when the question talks about audit risk, you guys talk about business risk and you explain how to mitigate that. When the question wants business risk, you guys somehow pull out audit risk. So that is one of the biggest issue in audit. You are unable to differentiate business risk and audit risk. If I'm talking about APM, the question is talking about evaluation of the performance reporting system of the company, whereas the student evaluates the performance of the company. They're asking you to evaluate the reporting system, not the performance. That one mistake majority of the students do. Similarly, the question talks about, for example, if I take SBR, the question talks about what should be the accounting treatment and what is the rectification entry. Students will only say that this is the mistake which is done, this is what is required. They don't write the rectification entry. So such kind of mistakes, you should not be doing it. Okay. And please make sure that you get a good healthy breakfast, not heavy breakfast. Get a healthy breakfast on the day of exam. And as I told you, keep a bottle of water ready. And any formulae, for example, financial management or else your APM students have Z score, Argent is A score. So those things, or else Lynch and Cross performance pyramid, balanced scorecard, building block model. For all this, you have formats or you have tables or you have contents to be recognized or memorized. So such kind of thing, audit and assurance students, standard numbers. Yes, ACCA have told that it is not mandatory to quote the standard numbers, but I told you guys, my students should quote standard numbers, right? Audit evidence, 500. Immediately it should pop up in your head. You should not think for that. You should not look out for that. It should be there in your head. And if you don't remember, fine, don't quote wrong numbers, ma. Only quote the numbers if you are absolutely fine and sure about the standard number. SBR students, mandatory to quote the standard numbers, otherwise you will not get the professional marks, right? Okay. And then moving on, things to remember during the examination. This one slide can make a difference between a failure and a success student, so please pay attention here. First and foremost important point is don't panic. Don't panic, don't get stressed out. See, already you have paid the examination fee. Already you have utilized or misutilized or screwed up your examination period. Your preparation period. You know, you are supposed to write the exam in June, way back. June exam got cancelled. Now you are writing in September. That means you got double the period which you are supposed to get. So, if you have already utilized it, absolutely fine. If you haven't utilized it, there is nothing you can do now. You cannot go back in time and correct it back. You are not Avengers. You cannot just go back and take the stones away from Thanos. Not possible. So simple fact is that what is gone is already gone. If you prepared well, you'll obviously pass the exam. If you don't prepare well, you don't have anything else to lose now. There is no reason for you to panic, as simple as that. So just go to the exam hall with a peace of mind. Keep your slate clean, as they say. Keep your mind free, keep your mind fresh. Don't have any thoughts in your mind. So what you will do is just keep your cool, keep your patience, keep your calm and give your best. As simple as that. Don't panic, guys. Don't panic. Don't try to take a stress that what happens if I fail. What happens if you fail? You will write December examination. Just because you panic doesn't mean that you will pass the examination if you haven't prepared properly or if you don't give your best in the exam. Panicking will only result in you losing the marks which you shouldn't be losing. You know, the answer is right in front of you. If you read the question a little bit careful, you'll get the answer. But you don't read the question because you are panicked. Right? See, for example, 90% of the FR students, financial reporting students, will do this mistake. 90%. I'll tell you what. You will read the question wrong. And even if you read the question right, for example, if there is a fill in the blank and the answer is, let's say, 33,000. You know, in the question, they'll say that what is the value of property, plant and equipment as on reporting date. Bracket, they'll say in thousands. You don't read that in thousands because you are panicked and you are in a hurry to complete the exam. And you will miss that. You will type in 33,000 in the answer. Indirectly, you just said that the answer is 33 million, not 33,000, because they asked you to report in thousands. So you should have written 33. You wrote 33,000. Gone. Your answer is gone. So read the question carefully. Read the question carefully. Twice, thrice, four times if required. Your answer will be right if you read it carefully. Okay? Next one. Read the requirements of the question first, not the scenario. Audit and assurance, APM, SBR, SBL, AAA, any paper for that matter. These papers are mandatory. Remaining students also should follow this. Read the requirement of the question, then read the scenario. For example, in AFM, they'll give you 2 pages or 3 pages of question. The requirements will be at the bottom. So if the students read the entire 2-3 pages and then go to the requirements, they don't remember anything. So again, after reading requirements, you have to go back and read everything. But the moment you first read the requirements, your brain already starts working. Okay, this is what I need to pull out from the question. This part is relevant for this requirement. So that starts, somehow subconsciously works in your brain. So first read the requirement, then read the scenario. And please remember, attempt the question which you feel more comfortable. So this question, I can literally make it my XYZ. So take that question, give your best, make sure that you are not wasting too much time, not spending too much time on the question you need. You know, usually APM students do this. First question, reporting, sir. I am pretty confident with reporting. So they'll spend 1 hour, 1.5 hour on the reporting question. And then they suddenly realize that, I still have section B to go through it. Now what am I supposed to do? And then they'll start panicking and then they'll try to crush their answers. From question one itself, plan your time management properly and start with the part which you feel comfortable and make sure that you put in more clarity of expression on that question rather than quantity of answer. Clarity and quality of the answer is more important than the quantity of the answer, right? Use the technology mark. Flag the questions which you don't know. Keep it on a flag so that even at the end, even if you click submit, it will say that you have some flagged questions. Go back and rectify them. And again, very bad misconception is that, sir, I have left some questions flagged. I answered them, but I did not remove the flag. What happens? Nothing will happen. See, flag is an option given to the student that will not be shown to the evaluator. Evaluator doesn't know which questions you have flagged or which you haven't flagged. Same applies for scratch pad. Evaluator doesn't have access to your scratch pad. So if you write your entire answer in the scratch pad, tada bye bye. See you in the next attempt. So scratch pad and your questions, which part you highlighted, which part you have given strike through, or else what you have done in your flagging, nothing will be shown to the evaluator except for your answer. So use these options as much as possible as and when it is required. Right? And before giving you the final conclusion, before saying goodbye, I want to say you one more thing, that is, please plan your answer properly and structured manner present it. Okay? Plan your answer properly, especially SBL students. You have only one question to answer in 4 hours. So please make sure that you plan your answer properly and then structurize it and then put it on paper. And SBR and APM students, read the requirement of the question, structurize the answer in your brain and then start writing it. Give reference points, whether you are using worksheet or whether you are using the document. Whichever you are using, absolutely fine, word processor or the spreadsheet. Make sure you do proper referencing as I have already shown in the respective video for SBR students. Right? So with that, I'll conclude this. I hope that I have covered all the points that you need. If you have any further issues, okay, you can contact us on WhatsApp 832-808-0730 number, or you can go to our website, you can drop us an email at info@globalfinex, or you can connect to me on any social media platforms, Facebook, Insta, or LinkedIn through Global Finex channel. Right, guys? So all the best for your examinations. I hope that all of you come out with a flying colors. Right, guys? Keep smiling. Take care. Stay cool. Stay calm. All the best. Bye-bye.